we move now to the issue of egalitarianism, well, according to you, what is egalitarianism?
Well, I can tell a way that I didn't put it, but it was put traditionally, that the life of everyone is to be considered equally. And that actually, if you just take it literally, is ridiculous. You don't treat a three-month-old child in the same way you do a 95-year-old human being.
Indeed.
So people have to be, so you have to have a conception of equality, which admits of different treatments of different people in different situations.
So it's an equality of status, not of treatment.
Yes.
Okay.
And so I thought in that book that I could find necessary and sufficient conditions to do the latter.
So when you talk about that book, I believe you are referring to Equality and Liberty, a defense of radical egalitarianism?
Yes.
Okay. So in that book, yes?
Yes, that's what I try to do there. And what
you
I
try to give
necessary and sufficient conditions.
Can you recall us what you think at that time would have been for you a good definition?
What I think I can give you is something that is older than that. That each is, it was a maxim that was used by a lot of people. Each is to count for one and none to count for more than one. Mm-hmm. That's what should be definitive of egalitarianism.
I see.
And you'd have to try to state that in a more systematic way, which I did.
Okay.
But I no longer think you can do that.
Okay, but just to clarify the terms, you talk about radical egalitarianism, so it's not pleonastic, so what does the adjective radical add to egalitarianism?
I could have put it thorough.
Thorough means applying to everyone, or thorough means a complete one concerning any individual?
It has to be a thorough one. But that's the thing where I was mistaken, because the reasons I just gave, you don't treat an infant the same way you do an adult. Don't treat an erotic person and a psychotic person in the same way that you treat.
Okay, so thorough egalitarianism meant almost the idea of a treatment that would have been equal. And then you moved away from that position.
Well, who convinced me to move that way from that position? That's actually a former student of mine, David Brundell.
Okay.
Who published a book called Pragmatic Egalitarianism.
Ah, I see.
And I think that's far closer. What it doesn't do is give a kind of conception, you know, of what's sufficient and necessary conditions. That's impossible. Yeah. But it gives a more pragmatic conception, and I think it's much better than mine.
Okay. Can you characterize is pragmatic egalitarianism?
Well, that is what I find difficult to do. When you read the whole book, you see for examples and context.
I see.
Because to characterize that would be just to do what I tried to do and couldn't do.
I see.
I thought I did regularly, but
So in a way, the pragmatic kind of egalitarianism is one that is always contextual, given a particular issue.
How do you manage
to implement egalitarianism in a particular issue will be very different from the application in another context.
What you say, if you're in Nepal, what you'd say is rather different than what you'd say when you're in Quebec.
Yeah, of course. So there are varieties of application. Mm-hmm. So it's a contextual approach to political philosophy.
Yes, exactly.
Okay, but not necessarily relativism.
It's contextual.
Contextual, okay. How does it play out now? Of course, you were influenced by his pragmatic egalitarianism, but how do you deal with that issue right now?
Well, what I say now is, well, we have this general idea, we need it to be contextual in the way that Rondell thought. But it's almost collapsed. We live in a great inning cauliflowering world. It's a horrible world. That's what, when we come to politics. Yeah. I don't think there's anything that looks like egalitarianism. Mm-hmm. I mean, we still have slave labor, not just labor, not what Marx called slave labor, mm-hmm. but actual slave labor.
Yeah.
That's impossible. I think that has come back.
Mm, it's unbelievable.
I wouldn't talk about equality so much. It has to do when we talk about philosophy. Okay. I think people would just laugh. It's a horrible world we live in.
Yeah. But
it doesn't seem to be getting any better.
No.
You might argue, well, it's better in Scandinavia than it is in Spain. To speak nothing of Libya.
But these facts, these actual facts of inequality, the increasing inequality between the very rich and the poor, these facts, they have an impact on your normative thinking? Do you think that you have to change your views concerning equality because of those facts?
Well, here's what I would answer. I don't think, and if I live long enough, I'll write about this, I don't think we can speak of the moral point of view as I did. There are moral points of view, and there are genealogies of morality. That's all we get. The idea of looking for the moral point of view is a dream of an illusion.
Okay, that...
And same thing says for equality.
Yeah, okay. So the moral point of view that you abandon or that you don't want to develop anymore is...
Well, it's not so much abandon or develop. I just think it was a
mistake.
I was caught with an illusion. A moral point of view is all right, but the moral point of view isn't.
I see. Ah, that's important. Because I was wondering whether you were rejecting completely the idea of amoral point of view.
If I live long enough, one thing I want to write about is nihilism. That's the complete rejection of a moral point of view.
I see.
And what worries me a lot is whether if you're driven just by rationality, whether you end up as a nihilist.
Yeah. Okay.
People have tried to stop that, including Nietzsche.
Okay.
But they've failed.
Mm-hmm. And just to add up to what you're saying, when you are describing the rejection of the moral point of view, and you accept that we can adopt a point of view that may be very amoral point of view that can be very different in one place from another, does that entail relativism?
I wouldn't think so.
Okay.
Because it doesn't mean somebody could say to me, you mean the Nazis had a moral point of view, yet they had the concentration camps? No, they didn't have any. This was just deeply immoral. Mm-hmm. But if you try to say, well, what is then to be really finally, ultimately moral? Mm-hmm. Is there the moral point of view? Well, if you look at things, that's why anthropology is important. If you look at things historically in anthropology, you see that never works out. Well, if somebody says, well, if you're sufficiently rational, it'll work out. Well, I'm not sure that no philosopher has ever been able to establish that. I don't believe in a critique of pure practical reason or a pure reason, period.
And so there are various instances of moral point of views that you can accept, but it's an instance of pluralism rather than relativism.
Yes. I keep to myself, well, suppose I've been an Inca And the Inca was a fairly developed society. It wasn't just a very primitive society, it was complex. Mm-hmm. Well, I have a very different conception of what the moral point of view was than if I'm a contemporary Quebecer.
Mm-hmm. And I suppose that there would have been relativism if in one particular context you would say, well, there are many different moral point of views acceptable with a very specific context. Maybe you would not accept that. You would say, no, in that context, there is a good moral point of view. Relativism would have led you to say that in a given context, in a given society, at one point, there are many different acceptable
points of views. That's a good way of putting it. There's somebody who is tough-minded enough to discover a relativistic point of view and go with it. Mm. I just think we need to be contextualists and pluralists. Okay. Take the idea that each is to count for one and none to count for more than one. That's a nice abstract thing, which I love. Mm. But what it comes to concretely is always contextual and historical.
That's very clear.